Good afternoon. I'm Nani Moore. I'm a member of the lecture committee. I'm representing the lecture committee of the activities committee, and we have lectures two times a month. For those of you who subscribe to the analogy that Stone Ridge Creek is a cruise ship that just never leaves the dock, we have our very own cruise ship lecturer here today. Ray Lanowski has been a resident of Stone Ridge Creek since the beginning, right? Four years. And whenever I ask him to give me a bio, he's very humble. He doesn't give me much to go on, but I do have Kay Johnson's article from The Standard a while back, and I'd like to read a few things from that article. Ray Ranowski, the featured artist on the Rendon Art Display beginning in September, this was last year, is not only an exceptional photographer, but is also an enthusiastic fisherman, writer and author. Ray grew up on a farm in Iowa, earned a degree in mechanical engineering from Iowa State, and an MS in engineering mechanics from San Jose State. He worked at Sandia in New Mexico before transferring to Sandia in Livermore. After he retired, after a very illustrious career, he decided to sign on with Princess Cruises as a lecturer. He did that for 6 years, did about 30 cruises, and gave about 150 lectures. He and Sheila continue to go on some of those cruises, and we have been the beneficiary of those trips because we've heard him speak on Panama Canal, Transcontinental Railroad, the Wild West, and most recently his birds of the local area. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce our resident wildlife photographer, Ray Ranowski, and we've got a treat in store.
I want to thank Noni and the committee and the activity department, and I especially want to thank Joan and Ron Hare. They are doing a fabulous job on the videography. They do a professional rendering of the video, so I'm really thankful for that. Of course, I want to thank you for coming and the support that you all give me, so I appreciate that. When I was on a Central American cruise, this was actually out of Baja, not Baja, California. It's a great place to do whale watching. I went out maybe 20 years ago, it's been quite a while, and went out on a whale watching cruise. We didn't see many, but we saw one whale that jumped three times. I missed the first two jumps, but I got the third one. And I want you to notice the cleats on the underside of this humpback whale. I will talk about that near the end of the talk. I'm going to break it up into three sections, one about this fish, particularly the sports fish. Now, I was a sports fisherman. I've been down there probably 30 or 40 times sport fishing. And then I'll talk about some of the birds. I started out with the lecture of Central America, so this is what it was all about. But then for this, I've added a number of pictures from along California and Alaska, so there's a few additions, and hopefully I didn't add so much that I can't get it all in this 1 hour time period. And then I'll talk about the whales, and I say plus. It's really about all the mammals, except I'm going to talk about turtles, and they aren't mammals, so mammals and turtles. I'd like to start with a question, give you something to think about. There are approximately 1,400 residents and employees at Stone Ridge Creek, and this is when it's full. We're not quite there yet. Which weighs more, these 1,400 people or one adult blue whale? Okay, I'll give you the answer, the official answer later on. The sports fish are big and spectacular. Some of the greatest sports fish, the toughest sport fish, are the tuna family. And there are four members of the tuna family. The albacore, which is the smallest one. the yellowtail, which is the biggest one. There's a bluefin tuna. There's a big-eyed tuna. But we don't know much about them. They have the bluefin tuna in the Pacific, but these aren't nearly as large as the one in the Atlantic. Our yellowfin tuna weighs a little over 400 pounds maximum. That's the biggest that's ever been caught. But the bluefin tuna in the Atlantic, you know, they can weigh, maybe a ton, or not a ton, 1,000 pounds, but 600 or 700 pounds. Sailfish are a spectacular fish that we have. They have a top speed of 68 miles per hour.
Wow.
Don't know how they measure that, but that's really fast. The salmon that we think are fast go maybe 10 to 15 miles per hour, so they really zoom. They're spectacular fish, and you can see why they're called sailfish. You see the big sail here. And at 68 miles per hour, you got to be as aerodynamic as you can be. And so that big sail folds down into a cavity in the back of the fish. This pectoral fin right here folds down into a cavity right here. You probably can't see it very well. But you can see that this little fin out here, you can see the cavity that folds into that cavity. So it can be really aerodynamic.
Hydrodynamic,
yeah. Same difference, different media. Same principles. And the marlin. Now, the sailfish go up to about 90 to 100 pounds, maybe 125, maybe a record is 150 or something. But the marlin get a lot bigger. This one, they estimate, right, they release them. So they estimated this one's like 450. And they get good. The crew knows what, you know, the right ballpark for the fish. But they do catch them more than 1,000 pounds, so they get really large. Dorado is kind of a neat fish, a very beautiful fish. This is the lure that it was caught on, and you can see the tail wrapped around behind the dorado. Now, what do we call them as a food fish? Mahi-mahi. And so we have that fairly frequently. It's a very good fish. And again, they're really colorful. They've got blue and green and whatever colors, all colors of rainbow pretty much. Wahoo is another fish. And if you go to Hawaii and order wahoo, well, what you really order is uno. Am I saying that right, uno? Yeah. And so they have really sharp teeth. And if you look at it there, when I first went fishing for wahoo, the skipper warned us, says, be really careful when there's a wahoo on the deck, because you know, they're very active. We keep these kind of fish. And he said that if one accidentally got your leg in its mouth, it will cut to the bone. It will cut the tendons. It will cut everything. He says if that happens, our fishing trip is over. We're heading for the emergency, and we're quite far offshore. So they really have sharp teeth. Sometimes we're trolling and all of a sudden you don't feel your lure, you don't feel your bait, you don't feel anything. Or wahoo has come along and just clipped your line. It just you don't even feel it. Flying fish. I know that the first time I saw a flying fish, I was on a fishing trip and saw this bird flying out in front of us. I said, wow, where did that come from? Well, I dove into the water, so then I knew where it came from. On one trip, and the flying is their defense mechanism. So they build up speed at the surface, you know, bring their wings out, and then they can glide for maybe a couple hundred feet or maybe quite a bit more than that. They, as they get down close to the water, they will take that tail and use their tail to, as a paddle or whatever you want to call it, but to keep going in the air. Twice on one trip, I saw Dorado chasing the flying fish. They were both in the air, but the Dorado can only leap a little ways, but the flying fish could go a long way, so it was a really good defense mechanism. One time when I was fishing, a flying fish, it may have been this one, but I'm not sure it was, but it hit me in the chest. Now, what happens, and this was before dawn, this was as the sun was coming up, what happens is that the best fishing on these boats is as the sun comes up, or while it's even darker than that. And the predator fish have really good eyes, and they develop their good eyesight quicker, or good vision quicker than the other fish, the bait fish. So it's a good time for them to use that. And so this happened before dawn, but it was still light out. Shark attack, white shark attack. Out of Guadalupe Island, which is off of the Mexican border, they have a lot of shark and they have a lot of tuna. So we were fishing down there, and the and somebody had a nice tuna. You know, that's probably a 40-pound tuna, maybe 30, whatever it is. And the white shark came up, and he just took one bite, and the fish stopped swimming. You bring in the head, and that's it. Now, and you can see, I wanted to show this because you can see that this is one bite of the shark. You know, he's just taking that. That's one. He just got his mouth around it and just bit it off. But a white shark weighs up to 5,000 pounds. It's big. One time we did this, and we put the fish that was bitten in two back in the water on the line. And a white shark came back and looked at it. I was lower beside the boat watching because, I wanted to see the white shark. And it did come, and I just gasped. The thing is so broad, so big, it's just so powerful. It really is awe-inspiring. It came back, and this, you can't see this very well, but there's the bait, and there's the white shark. That's the mouth of the white shark. He took it in his mouth, but he didn't keep it very long. Going farther north now, I want to talk about rockfish and lingcod that we catch off of California, we catch off of Alaska, but it is a cool water fish. The water temperature changes around Santa Barbara. South of that is a warm water current. North of that is a cool water current. And so these are cool water fish. The one that you see here is a yellow-eyed rockfish. So there it is right there. And it's the premium rockfish. I mean, the rockfish are all good. And you know what we eat, rockfish, it's Pacific snapper. And they're an excellent fish. I mean, I used to think halibut was the best fish, best white fish. And I don't think I believe that anymore. I think it is just not as clear as this. It's such an unobtrusive taste. I think halibut has a little flavor to it that I'm not too fond of. But these are not legal to keep anymore in California. They're very slow growing, so you can't keep them. But there are more than 50 varieties of rockfish, all colors of the rainbow. They're blue, black, yellowtail, pretty much everything you can think of, and they're all very good eating. And so, man, I've eaten a lot of rockfish in my day. The lingcod is the premium, and it's not a rockfish, it's a different species, but the premium bottom fish. This one probably weighed, the yellow-eyed rockfish was around 10 pounds. This one probably maybe 20, maybe more like 15. They have a sharp set of dentures, as you can see, and the way they fish is they catch other fish and hold on. So with those teeth, they don't have any trouble holding on to another fish. In fact, sometimes you'll hook a smaller fish, and the fish will be coming up, and all of a sudden, it's a bigger fish. And the lingcod has latched on to the fish, and it is really reluctant to give that up. Now, we're catching these from 200, 300 feet a lot of time, and so it'll come all the way up with that fish, occasionally, fairly frequently, in fact. And if somebody is standing by with a gaff and gaffs that lingcod, you can catch the lingcod even without hooking it. Salmon is really our most premium fish, and we have big king salmon here, some of the best king salmon fishing in the world. Now, you can go to Alaska and catch king salmon, and that's fine, but the limit is like one or two per season. They're really restricted because it's limited. But here, we're able to catch two per day, and there's no season limit on it. So it has a fairly long season. The season has been cut down as there's been the salmon been impacted and shorter and shorter. Once in a while we catch other things like octopus. Now this octopus may weigh a pound or pound and a half, whatever it is, not very big, but they do get bigger. One time I was fishing out of Deep Reef, is what we called it. It's a reef that's about 300 feet deep, as west of Half Moon Bay or Pillar Point. We were fishing in a small boat with three guys, three friends fishing. And so I hooked this thing. It wasn't fighting. It was kind of strange. It'd fight a little, and then it would, and then it'd fight a little. But I kept cranking and got it up to the surface. And it was a octopus, but it was a big octopus. And so one of the guys that I was fishing with reached down with the gaff and was going to jerk, pull it into the boat. And he just kind of nicked the web, but it pulled out, so it didn't get in the boat. But the octopus swam under the boat, and about that time we told the third person on the other side of the boat, says, "You'll never guess what we've got." He said, "Yes, I will. His tentacles are coming in on this side of the boat." So we decided that this octopus has 8 arms and the 3 of us only had 6. So we really maybe don't want to keep this octopus. And so then I slacked off on the line, and the octopus then released itself from the bottom of the boat, and then the line came taut, and he immediately shot out a jet of ink. And he was dark, and it shot out this dark jet of ink, and it immediately turned to a much brighter color. And you could say, yeah, I can see where that would work. The predator would be going after that ink spot. That looks like the octopus. And so it's just a wonderful defense mechanism. When we were up at Humboldt State, up out of Eureka, and went to the aquarium, they had a giant octopus. And this is what I caught. And the giant octopus can weigh up to 100 pounds. They told us that they got it as a smaller octopus and everything was okay, but it was getting pretty large. And so when they went in to clean the tank or do anything in the tank, they would have somebody standing by. They were afraid the octopus might hold the person under and pull his breathing cord out and drown him. So they had this person standing by. And they said, "It's about time to feed the octopus. Do you want us to see us feed the octopus?" So I said, we said, "Sure." And so they had a Dungeness crab, they threw it down the tank and kind of went to the corner, cowered over there, and the octopus was the other end of the tank, and it was kind of square, it wasn't very big. And it took him just a minute, he then just darted down and just got onto that crab like a tent. And so he moved up along the side of the edge of the aquarium, and I'm thinking that the Dungeness crab was a good-sized Dungeness crab. I'd say at least 8 inches, maybe 10 inches across there. So this is a big animal. In Alaska, you fish for everything, but sometimes you go out and set crab pots for the day, and then go out and fish for fish and come back and pull the crab pot. We've done that a few times, and this one time it was off of Kodiak Island. We got a king crab. I was thinking, we had king crab here at Easter time, didn't we? So this is what we had then. We catch a lot of halibut up out of Alaska. The restrictions are tighter and tighter on it, and the fish that we're catching are not as big as they used to be. It's really been impacted on size. But this was a few years ago, maybe 15 years ago or so. Oops, I don't want to do that yet. And so the three of us each grabbed one of the biggest fish caught that day and had our picture taken. And the biggest fish there, I don't think it's 100 pounds, it may be 80 or something like that. But they do get quite a bit bigger. In fact, there have been 400-pound halibut that have been caught. This one was 238 pounds. The guy back here, there's our guide, and he was like 6'2" and pretty burly guy, so it was a big fish. I'll transfer over to the birds now. I like this picture of the seagulls. I took a lot of pictures with the setting sun and the birds. And this one I looked at, wow, that's a pretty nice picture. So I like that picture. And I tried to duplicate it. I've never been able to duplicate it since. But you can see in the background is a brown pelican, and the foreground is a seagull. And you would think from this picture that the seagull is bigger than the pelican. Well, that's not true. The seagull weighs around a pound, maybe as much as 3 pounds, and the pelican weighs about 7 pounds. And the seagulls are, they're so noisy that the seashore just wouldn't be the same without the squawking seagulls. And so and they get pretty tame, and so we go out fishing, and we have some bait left over. And as we come in, we throw out bait to him. This guy's all right, he'd hold it up. So he held it up, the seagull took it right out of his hand. The brown pelican, and this is a success story. Remember when we had DDT, and we thought, wow, that was the greatest thing, and we spray our towns with DDT to take care of insects? This is back in Iowa, where I was, not so much out here. And it would kill the flies around the barns, and wow, we thought we really had something. Well, it turned out that the DDT would accumulate, and first it would start out in the insects, then it would go into small fish and, you know, get into water systems, small fish and bigger fish, and each time the concentration of DDT got higher, and the pelicans were eating the medium or large fish, and so the DDT affected the shells on their eggs, and they were soft, and so the pelicans were nesting, hatchling, trying to hatch with little ones, and they break the eggs, so they did not hatch successfully, and the brown pelican was an endangered species. Now, since we've got the DDT out of our system, there are pelicans every place. They're definitely not a danger. And they're up along our west coast, down into Mexico, on our east coast, south coast. Not in the colder weathers, there's limits, but they're really successful. When we would come out and go out fishing and then come back in, we'd throw a bait over the side of the boat or the back of the boat, or clean the fish and throw the inward in the back of the boat. Well, the birds would fight over it. And so this brown pelican, I remember, made just a really sharp turn. And okay, how do you do that? Well, you can see he's using his foot as an air brake to make the turn. So they're amazing animals. Boobies. If you're down in the warmer parts of the Pacific, you're going to see boobies. And you see lots of them on cruises. They'll fly along cruises, and they kind of fly not too much faster than cruise ships, so you kind of get a pretty good chance to take pictures of them. These were actually taking off of a fishing boat, as it turns out. This is a brown booby, and it has a white underside, or light underside, and a brown back. You can notice that it has a distinct facial structure, the beak and so on. I'll talk about that a little bit more in a minute. We had one on a fishing boat off of southern Mexico. There were actually two of them. There's another one here. And they were spending the night there, and the next morning they weren't very anxious in moving. You just almost had to poke them to get them to move. And I like this picture, and do you remember the young Dr. Frankenstein? Remember Igor was played by Marty Feldman?
Yeah.
Well, I don't know why, but if I just kind of look at this part of it, you know, that right there, he wore that hoodie, and I think it looks like Igor. And you can see that the hairline, actually the feather line, is like this, and the beak is like this, and that's true of all boobies. They're brown boobies, brown-footed boobies, blue-footed boobies, white mass boobies, and so on. And so this is a mass booby. This is a little heavier than some of them. This weighs a little over 3 pounds. Some of them weigh a little less than 3 pounds. And there again, you can see that the structure, you can see why it's called a mass booby, and you can see the structure of the feathers and the eye and so on. They are excellent swimmers. They dive in after the fish. What happens is the boat goes through the water and disturbs the fish and it swims out. It seems to swim near the surface. And so the boobies spot that, they hover off of the boat, and they spot that, and then they dive down to pick up the bait fish. And they're really good underwater. They tuck those wings in, and they really swim well underwater. And it seems to me that they usually get their fish. The magnificent frigate bird. Very interesting bird. It is not like a duck. Its feathers are not oiled. It cannot land in the water and take off. If it lands in the water and can't paddle ashore, it's done. It cannot fly. So it flies out above the water. I've heard, and this sounds incredible, that it can be out in over water for as much as 56 days. The frigate weighs about 3.3 pounds and has a wingspan of 90 inches. You know, add a foot to each of my arms, and that's its wingspan, and it weighs 3 pounds. And it has the largest wingspan to weight ratio of any bird. So it rarely flaps its wings. It just flies. It uses thermals to gain altitude. Very efficient bird. But they can't land in water, and they can't dive down the water to get their food or into the water. So how do they do it? Well, you can see this frigate has a pretty nasty beak, kind of like a hawk or an eagle. And it will go after other birds that have caught a fish, like the boobies, and he'll harass the one that's caught the fish until it drops this bird, then swoop down and either pick it up or go down and pick it up off the water. So here's a frigate bird hunting. And this one, I apologize for the picture, it's not very good, but it's the only thing I've got. And you can see these are the wings of the frigate bird. This is its head here. And it points its head down, grabs the bait, which is right here, and lifts it up. So he does this all without getting his wings wet. And it has another characteristic, that it has this big red pouch that inflates during baiting season. And I think of this picture saying, look at me, how magnificent a bird am I. Now I'm moving up to our area. And we see a lot of shorebirds. And I love the avocet. We see them, they are down in the Coyote Hills where we went for a walk recently. We didn't see them, but they were there. And this one is on the shoreline at Monterey Bay. And this was taken about a month ago or 6 weeks ago. They have this curved beak. They thrust that down into the water to the bottom and then move it from side to side to disturb what's going on, or pick up worms, or pick up any kind of food down there. And this is a bird I've only seen once, and this was about 6 weeks ago on that same trip. It was off Monterey, in Monterey Bay, close to shore, and it's a surf scotter. It weighs about 2.5 pounds. It's a duck-like thing, but it, you know, the bill is so unique that it's interesting to see birds like that. We have the cormorants. We have cormorants here too, but they have cormorants out in salt water. They weigh about 3 to 3.5 pounds, and you can see the way they take off. I think it's so neat the way they take off, and he's you know, just running and flapping, and boy, is he working to get up into the air. And so eventually he gets up enough speed he can then take off. This was also taken at Monterey Bay on that same trip. Alaska's magnificent birds, the bald eagle. What is Alaska's state bird? It's not the bald eagle.
Ptarmigan.
The ptarmigan, willow ptarmigan. Yeah, good for you. You get an A. And so the bald eagle weighs just under 10 pounds, maybe 9.5 pounds average or typical. This was up in Juneau where I was taking, I don't want to do that quite yet. This is up in Juneau, and there was kind of a foggy day, and they are at the top of the trees, so you don't get very close. And over here, I was out fishing at a camp, and they put some fish guts out there or something, the eagles would come down, so I got down close and laid on the wharf and was hoping they wouldn't see me, but they wouldn't come too close to me. And it was pretty dark, it was hard to get much of a picture. But then there's a captive eagle like this one, and you can really get an idea of what their feather line is like and their beak. Sometimes, a couple of times, we've seen a gull out in the ocean, and we're fishing, and the gull is standing on something, think, well, it's a piece of driftwood or something. So that there's a lot of nothing on an ocean. And so if there's anything that's a little bit different, it'll attract fish. So, well, there's something over there, we'll go over, we'll troll over by that. But as we get closer, the log dives, it's a turtle, and then the gull takes off. Turtles can be pretty big. The biggest one is a leatherback, and I don't know what this one is, actually. But a typical weight of a leatherback is like 1,000 pounds, and they've been caught at 2,016 pounds. And you can see that these are sea turtles or sea animals with the flippers up here like fins rather than things you use on land. They have hatcheries. It's a pretty simple hatchery. This is down in Mexico, and I've even forgotten what
what town we were at, and on one of the cruise or the tours they took us to this. Now, each one of these is a stake that shows a nest of somebody. Now, interestingly, if they bury them in sand that is less than 83 degrees, they mostly will become males. If you bury them in land in sand that's more than 87 degrees, they will mostly become females. So you can choose the sex you want. Now you can see there's not much to that. And so they have a pond, a place to keep the little turtles, and then they, before they get very old, they'll take them out on the beach and let them waddle into the water. And you can see on this that you can see the flippers already are kind of like their adults. In Monterey, we saw some harbor seals. I hadn't seen this before, but they're down by the Hopkinson Laboratory, just northwest of that along the beach. We saw maybe 35 or so on the beach at one time. So these weigh about 250 pounds, 220 maybe. But they're a pretty big animal, bigger than I thought. And I went on the cruise to Alaska. It was May of last year. And we saw some harbor seals. And they're out on the ice floe. Now, the reason they're on the ice floe is that if they're in the water, they've got all kinds of predators, killer whales, and things that will take care of them, pick them off, and so they spend a lot of time on the ice floe. And this is, technically, I guess it's an iceberg. I was fishing in Alaska one time. We were out on the Alaskan Peninsula, or Aleutian Islands is actually where we were. And guide that we've been fishing, and he says, if you want to take an afternoon off and go see some walruses. And I said, sure, that'd be fun to do. So we got in the beaver airplane and flew over to a beach, landed on the beach up a ways from the east, and hiked back maybe a half mile or quarter mile. I want to point out this pinnacle right here. I don't know if you can see it or not, but I'll show it to you. There's got to be over 1,000 in this, and they're a big animal. They're over 1,000 pounds. I've got the notes on it. I think they're up to a couple thousand pounds. So as we hiked along to get to see the walruses, our guide said, well, Ray, I'm going to put you out on this pinnacle pointing to this. And I wasn't sure I wanted to be out on that pinnacle, but it was okay, you know, it was fine. So as we were hiking along and the ledge was up in here, you know, so then just climbed out on the pinnacle. And so I was right above the walruses. And so these are the kind of pictures that I got. The males and the females both have tusks. And they're kind of a strange looking animal. The tusks could be like a meter long, about a yard long. And they have a thick layer of blubber. So I thought, well, this walrus down here is pretty tolerant of having that sharp tusk poked into it. My wife says that the caption for that photo ought to be ouch. So that's the caption for the photo. We see a lot of dolphins, and any of you have been on cruises have seen dolphins. This was on a fishing trip, and so we're down pretty close to the water. This is a pantatropical spotted dolphin, weighs about 260 pounds, is about 8 feet long. And you can see the blowhole over here. They come up, where they come up, but just up and down, and in just an instant, they got their breath of air. So I saw this and was interested that, okay, he's expelling the air out of his lungs now. He's not even out of the water yet. But his nose is out of the water, his beak is out of the water, and I think his fin is out of the water. So he knows where he is, he probably knows anyway. But he starts to expel before he's out of the water, and then as soon as he surfaces, he takes in a big breath. They seem to jump, and say, oh, I take a picture of it. They're jumping every place. But you know, you point off this direction, he jumps off that direction. If you're persistent, pretty soon you get a picture of him jumping. One we were around this, and that school of dolphins were there for quite a while. I mean, there were hundreds of, probably thousands in that school. It was really big. And so they were just on milling around, and all of a sudden, they all went one direction. And I'm not sure what happened, but I think what happened is that they found some fish, and then they got a signal, so okay, we're all going to attack those fish. And they have a sonar system, and so this illustrates how it works. And so they could spot these in their sonar system, but from I think a mile or more away. What's the largest dolphin species? You actually know it, but you just don't know.
Orca.
Orca, absolutely right. Congratulations. Wow.
What is it?
Orca, killer whale.
Killer whale.
And you know, you say, okay, it's a whale, but it really is. It fits the description of a dolphin better. They can be up to 20,000 pounds. They're big animals. The male, which is the male, which is the female. Well, the male is usually more gaudy, and so this is the male. And the dorsal fin is about 6 feet long. And then the female over here. And then there are the whales, the sperm whale. Sperm whale weighs about 90,000 pounds. And they can, and these are, they hunt fish, and they, you know, they hunt a number of things, but the giant squid is one of the things that they hunt. They can hold their breath for an hour and a half. And they will dive, and I've heard two extreme figures. One is about 1,000 meters, so about 3,200 feet. And the other is a mile and a half. So they really get down a long ways to get their fish. They eat about 3 tons of fish a day, so they've got to be good hunters. And of course, this is the Moby Dick. Moby Dick was a sperm whale. And of course, it was white, but this one is Moby Dick. The humpback whale, about my favorite whale. And you can see that they're such wonderful animals. I talked about one cruise that I took and took a whale-watching tour out of it, but then recently, I took another whale-watching tour, and there were a lot of whales. It was just an amazing day to see whales that day. We were seeing a lot of them. And this is one of the big mamas. This is a big whale, probably 80 or 90,000 pounds. It has the pectoral fins like this, and it has kind of an elbow. It just does amazing things with that fin. It turns it, rotates it. They come up, and they leap out of the water like this, and then they rotate, and then they come down, and they just, if they can touch, they make a really big splash. Now, we don't have any of these in our food service. Zach's in the background. And I just included a few other pictures just to show how they operate, and that, you know, they're using this pectoral fin, which is like 15 feet long, the longest pectoral arm of any animal. And you can see they're spraying up the water with that fin as they go out of the water. They rotate, the white underside of the fin is coming around, and then they dive down into the water. And if you want to get a picture like this, you need to take that picture almost as the tail comes out of the water. You need to be quick, otherwise you won't get the water coming off of it. The tail is also about 15 feet wide, maybe a little wider than that. They have a blowhole, and this, my son-in-law took this picture, and it has a double blowhole right here. You can see that there are two holes. Not all whales have a double blowhole. This is a baleen feeder, and I'll talk about that in a minute. But they seem to characteristically have a double blowhole, and I don't know why. Oops. And you'd think that that blowhole would be blowing the back, but they don't. They blow straight up. You can see this plume coming right out of that hole. When I was in Alaska in May of last year, I wanted to get pictures of a bubble feeding. the Wales bubble thing. I had some from a long time ago, but I wanted to get some current ones and maybe some better ones. So I took a whale watching tour in the morning, came back, we saw some whales, didn't see anything like bubble feeding. But as we got back to on the boat, there were whales, there were at least two of them, maybe there were more, that were feeding on herring or whatever the bait fish was in the bay. So they would drive that bait fish up to near the shallows and then come up and gulp and take in a bunch of bait fish. The way they feed is they get a mouthful of water, and they don't have teeth. What they have is baleen. And you can't see it very well here, but it's short up in front. It gets longer as you go back. And it's got just a cartilage. It's not like a tooth. They were used for corsets, for ladies' corsets in the early days. So the way they typically feed is that they spot a school of herring or whatever it is, and there are schools of herring all over, so it isn't hard for them to spot them. And then they swim along, they take several breaths to really fill up their lungs. Then they threaten the herring, and what herring do when they're threatened is go into a tight ball. So they then dive, and when they dive, you can see the back comes up, and then the tail comes up. If you see the tail come up, the whale is going to be down for a while, a few minutes, maybe 5 minutes or whatever. But they go down, and one of the whales blows a bubble net as it circles around the herring, below the herring, and this bubble net is a barrier to the herring. They don't want to swim through that bubble net. So then all the whales come up simultaneously and open their mouths, scoop in lots and lots of water, you know, thousands of gallons of water, and then the baleen filters out the fish. Just to give you a little perspective here, so this is the nose of the whale. That's the blowhole. Here's another nose of a whale here with that, those humps on it. A pectoral fin here, the mouth of a whale here. And so they come up, and you can see that this one has expelled most of its water. You can see the baleen if you're up close. But it's really a big cavity, their mouth. And they've taken a lot of water. One last picture of this. And you can see, and I mentioned to that the plating on the fish, the underside of the fish, was important. So you can see what happens is they use that plating to really make a big basin here. And her mouth is expelled. Now, I should explain that this is the upper jaw of the whale. This is the upper jaw of another whale. And so they've got it open. They're going to close that down to capture the fish inside and expel the water. Which weighs more, a blue whale or the 1,400 residents that we're going to have and employees that we're going to have?
Whale.
Whale, okay. To help out a little bit, the whale is the largest animal, blue whale is the largest animal that's ever lived. The largest land animal is an elephant, and it weighs like 14,000 pounds. It would take 30 elephants to make one blue whale.
Wow.
And the whale calf that's born weighs 8,000 pounds. So it is a calf is bigger than any land animal except the elephant. The hippopotamus and the rhinoceros are close. So it weighs 210, the biggest one, that weighs 210 tons or 420,000 pounds. And we would have to average 300 pounds each. So I do this thing, you know, when I was doing this on a cruise, there'd be 2,000, 2,500 people on the ship, and I can still do this. So, questions or comments?
You mentioned that king salmon were scarce in the Alaskan waters. I caught a couple of white king salmon.
Yes.
From Kodiak. Is that a well, it's just a...
I can repeat the question if you want.
Are you familiar with the white salmon?
Yes,
salmon? Are they quite rare?
They are. I've never caught one, but I know
Excellent eating, by the way.
Yeah, right. It was really good.
The flesh is white instead of pink.
You know, one thing I was thinking about is a lot of salmon we get here are, you know, farm salmon. They're Atlantic salmon. Sometimes we get the wild Chinook salmon, but a lot of times it's that. But if you're eating rockfish, I don't think they've learned how to farm rockfish, Pacific snapper, and you're getting wild fish. So it's got some advantages. And I'm sure that's true of a lot of the other things. But.
My husband was a salmon fisherman. He used to go out to Farallon.
Yes.
He claimed that the color of the meat and the salmon had to do with what they were feeding on. In other words, that ones he used to catch, the fish he used to catch came in really pink to red. They were wonderful. And he said because they fed on a lot of shrimp.
Yes. So the comment was that the her husband used to fish for salmon and caught a lot of the king salmon, and they are red, dark, you know, red, deep pink color because they eat the shrimp, and actually they eat a lot of krill, which I think is what gives them their color. And the farm salmon, they give them something, you know, they give them antibiotics and stuff, but they also include something to color the salmon.
Our nature leader over many years from Pleasanton, she took a long time for us to see a big shark swimming beneath us, and I have never seen her stared at anything in the ocean, and she came up and her eyes were about that big.
So Marie's saying that somebody was not afraid of anything, but was she swimming?
You're all in the ocean.
Okay, so I saw this shark, and she was scared of the shark. She came up. So one of the things that
she was just passing by.
one of the places that people go if they want to see sharks, you know, underwater, is the Guadalupe Islands. It's off of Mexico, south of probably west of Baja, mostly. And people go down there and take trips, and they go in diving cages. And the water is clear down there, and they have shark, and they have tuna also. Now, the tuna can swim at 40 miles per hour. The tuna can swim at 60 plus miles per hour, and the shark can swim at 40 miles per hour. And so they get along just fine until a tuna gets hooked and is slowed down. Then the shark can catch him. And so the ones I was showing it. It's because it's on the hook that the shark can catch them.